Good morning, my name is Amrit Prahlad. I am from National Institute of Technology, Rourkela. It's in the eastern part of India. As a Khurana scholar, I have been working here in Robert Novak's lab. It's in the EC department in Engineering Hall. So the title of my project is Efficient Structural Learning of Biological Networks. First, I will show you a picture of a biological network. This is how a biological network looks like. It's a genetic network of yeast. So it is made in such a way that the genes that have similar in functions, they are clustered together, and the different colors here, these colors correspond to different functions. So the importance is, from these clusters we can say which gene has which function, so it's highly predictive of biological functions. And from chemical genetic interactions, it can be known that which chemical creates hypersensitivity in which part of the map or in which cluster. So it leads to identification of a target or drug or chemical, and hence drug discovery. So the question is how to build this biological network. So I will discuss some of the methods that being used currently, and later I will say an efficient way to do that. So the first step of the current method is to measure the interaction values between each gene. So that is done by an experiment called an FGA, synthetic genetic array. So let's say we have two cells, this is A, this is B. Then it undergoes gene knockouts as this and this. So they become single mutants now. Then they are allowed to mate, and double mutants are formed, and the correct double mutant is isolated. Now let's say this is AB, this is A, this is B. So the fitness FAB, FA and FB is measured, and it is put in this formula. This epsilon gives the interaction value between cell A and cell B. So if that interaction value is above the threshold, it's considered to be a significant interaction. Now these interaction values built up the interaction profile or feature vector for each gene. So let's say one gene interacted with 10 other genes. So for simplification, I have shown a binary interaction profile. So if there is an interaction between the one gene and 10 other genes, there will be 1, and if there is no interaction, there will be 0 in the corresponding places. So the database on which the current experiments were done is an online yeast gene database. It's called DryGene. There 4458 genes were taken. It was split into two sets. One was called a query set and an array set. The query set had 1711 genes, and the array set had 385 genes, and it looked somewhat like this. So the query set, were stored as shown here as in rows, and the array set was stored as in columns. And these are the interaction values between a query gene and an array gene. So for each query gene, each row will be its interaction profile, and for each array gene, each column will be its interaction profile. So NAN means not a number, it means there is no interaction between a query gene and an array gene, and these numbers show the interaction. So the step 2 is to find out the similarity between the genes using correlations. So let's say the interaction profile of gene 1 is this, and this is the interaction profile of gene 2. So to find out the correlation, one has to multiply these corresponding values. So this comes as this, and then add it up. So the correlation means that the genes that are highly correlated, they are more similar, so they should be together in a cluster. And the genes that are lowly correlated, they should be farther apart because they have no similarities. So when the next step is to group all the similar genes together and to move all the genes that are not similar further apart. So that is done using some clustering techniques. So these light boxes represent that all the genes are clustered together. So these are the clusters. And this dark part represents that they are like lowly correlated, and these are the highly correlated parts. So from here we get the clusters, and then those clusters are brought together to form a functional map as was shown in the first picture. But the problems that we face in the current methodologies are, to build up these interaction profiles or this type of genetic network map, exhaustive measurements has need to be done. So lots of experiments needs to be done. So for each query gene, to build up its interaction profile, it has to interact with each of the array gene. So let's say in dry gene, we had 1711 pedi and 3 different arrays. So total experiment that needs to be done is around 6 million. So one way to make it efficient is this. Evidence and previous studies shows that biological processes are sparse. This means that each gene will never interact with all of the genes, but it interacts with its own kind of similar functional genes. Hence they cluster together with its own similar functional genes later on. So if this is the interaction profile of a gene, this is sparse and it has just two non-zero elements. So for the next gene, its interaction profile is sufficient to measure this. We don't need to do all these experiments and get its values, because ultimately when you find a similarity between these two genes, these values will be multiplied, and as these are zeros, those will be cancelled. So there is no need to do all these experiments. So this is just between two genes. In general, if we have to make an algorithm for a data set, so this is the algorithm. It's something like, if we have n query genes and m array genes, so we randomly pick some query genes, let's say that's p, 1, 2, up to p out of n. So let's say we pick p query genes. For all these p query genes, we did the method is to do all the exhaustive measurements to get the complete interaction profiles of all these p query genes. Then the union of these interaction profiles should be done. So this is the union. It's the OR function of each of the feature vector. So from here we get all the points that are non-zero or have significant interactions. So for the next set of genes, that is n minus p query genes or n minus p genes, there is no need to do all the experiments. It's just sufficient to measure at these points. As I said, because these values will be ultimately multiplied, and as these are zeros, they will be cancelled. So for each n minus p gene, we will save some experiments. So here it's like we save 6 experiments. So these were the simulation results. It was done in MATLAB. So the code was made such that it will pick out of, let's say we had 4 random query genes and 6 to 4 array genes. It will pick some of the query genes, some of the array genes, the sparsity range of the query genes in the scale of 0 to 1, and array genes were recorded, and the mean sparsities were also recorded. These are also in the scale of 0 to 1, and each of these experiments were done for 100 times and it was averaged. Okay, I will speak about RAND index. RAND index is in a scale of 0 to 1. It measures the similarity between the previous method and this method. What it does, it sees how many genes were in same cluster here and also in the same cluster in this method, and which the genes that are in different clusters here are also in a different cluster here. And so it measures a kind of similarity, and in the scale of 0 to 1, it can say how similar are the clusterings there and here. So from here we see that if we tend to move towards the total number of query genes and total number of array genes, that's this, it tends to be 1, because then the clusters here and there in both the methods are almost similar. But rather, if you pick some of the query genes that are very few, then also the RAND index is very high. It's like above 0.97. So this is a picture of the original method that was used in which exhaustive measurements were done. So these were like the clusters, and this is the current efficient method. So here the correlation values get changed, that's where the color gets changed, but the sense of clustering remains same. That means the genes that were having high correlations are also having high correlations relatively, so you can see the clusters here. And as the RAND index is high, so most of the elements are in the correct clusters here. And if you look at, this is the original, the exhaustive measurements picture, and if we rearrange these clusterings in the clustering order of our efficient method, then we will get a picture like this. So you can see that most of the clusterings or the clusters are correct, as it looks very similar. So this method can be applied not only this query array gene or something, it can be applied to any general problem of size in which there is sparsity in a process, and also it can be applied anywhere where correlation measurements are done to find out the similarities. So in unknown biological databases, the average sparsity of each gene can be known from expert biologists, and then we can proceed to use this method. So the future work, I would say, to build up a mathematical model to quantify the things of how many genes to pick and what. So it first, from very naive calculation, it was like it seemed that the it's in the order of log total number of elements. But in that case, the number of experiments to be done in exhaustive method is m cross n, where m and n are the array of varied genes, and the efficient method is this. But we have to check it further whether it's true or not, and so that's the future work. And acknowledgements is Professor Robert Novak, so he's sitting right there. And Gautam, he is my co-guide, he is a grad student in the lab. And everyone in the Kona program, Department of Bioenergy, Government of India, in the US Science Technology Forum, Global Medicine, and to all my Kona friends. Thank you.